Hello, good evening, and welcome to another session with me, Varun, on Tech Tablet. And in this session or in this video, we would be looking at some interview questions. So this is the beginning of a whole new range of a series of videos wherein the agenda would be to talk about different perspectives of how a fresher to an experienced candidate can crack an interview that is based out of machine learning. And the languages or the technologies we would be focusing on initially would be multifold, wherein it would be on R and Python predominantly, and then we would be spreading into other languages or other technologies too. So the agenda of this session in specific would be to talk about some interview questions that are asked at a very basic level to those people who are aspiring to become machine learning engineers or probably engineers who really would want to work on data analysis. And this is mostly, as I said, at a basic level. So anyone who's a fresher or who's just looking for an opening in this field of data, I think this video is exactly for you. And to give you all a small introduction about me, my name is Varun, and I've been working as a developer on SAP ABAP, quickly moved on into SAP UI5, then started my own YouTube channel, which is Tech Tablet, followed by another couple of channels, and then started rapping as my passion, and that came out to be pretty nice. And then currently I work as a data science trainer and as a YouTuber and as a rap or as an independent artist as well. And I train or I work on different technologies, that is R, Python for machine learning and deep learning. And to follow me or to have or to talk about any queries, you can reach out to me on Instagram at Hyderabadi_Chora, which also happens to be the name of my rap profile. So now going forward, what can you do when you have to import a data set but the file is not found? So when you know that the file is not found, the way I see it, there can only be three mistakes. The first mistake is you either might have imported the wrong path, or you might have written the wrong path, or the second one could be wherein you have a wrong working directory. You might not have set up the right one, and the third one could be you might not have given a .csv as a suffix. And we all know that .csv as a suffix is a mandate. It could be .excel or it could be whatever. You have to give the format of the file that you would want to work on. And if you notice carefully, these steps are pretty much same for Python or R. It's very important for you to choose the right working directory folder, after which I don't think it should be a problem for you to work on any data set. How would you differentiate between independent and dependent variable? Well, independent variable and dependent variable are represented as small x and capital Y, or capital X and small y. I prefer the second way, but there's a lot of them who prefer the first way too. And here the independent variables are input data that you have wherein based on which you want to predict something. And this something that we're talking about is the dependent variable. So to give you an example, if I have height and weight, then we all know that based on height of a person, I would be able to predict his weight, and it's not vice versa. Because with my height, I'll keep growing in my age, I'll keep growing in my weight too, right? And as we all know, this is how we try to detect, or we try to predict values. And this is how we identify the difference between independent and dependent variables. Going further, the next question that we have is, why do we create X and Y separately in Python? So in Python, you have two libraries, the first one being pandas and the second one being numpy. So when we talk about pandas, which is panel data, here you mostly work on data frames, while in numpy, we work on array. So array is more convenient format to process the data or to build machine learning models. And this is the reason why we create two separate arrays, one which contains, capital X and small y, one which contains our independent variables and the one which contains our dependent variables. That is input features and the one that we would want to predict. So this is how it works. And what is the use of iloc? So iloc is a functionality that you have in Python. You can use this whenever you would want to kind of call, or whenever you would want to see a column based on its index. So you're not naming the column, you can directly tell that this is the number of, if you want to probably take a look at the fourth column or the fifth column, you can directly use iloc. then what is values dot values used in Python 4? It returns the values of the columns that you are taking inside a NumPy array. So if I would want to check the values or what is my column filled with, in that case I would be using dot values, and this would give me an insight about what do I have within that column in specific. And this is how X and Y become NumPy arrays, right? The sixth one is, in R as language, why do we use average function when replacing the missing values by mean of a column can be done in a much simpler way like this. So as you can see, we have a small functionality within the mean, and that functionality is you can replace, I mean, you can remove them and you can replace them with the mean directly. But we don't want to do that. Or you may have another alternate too, which is, now if you would want to kind of group on a certain set of values, or if you would want to probably, let us say that there are certain other features or subsets that you might want to calculate the mean of, in that case having this function becomes more prominent, and that is when it would be really be useful, or it would be more accurate when you want to replace the missing values using a mean. So though the functionality remains to be the same, you can use it for a specific set of purposes if and where required. Seventh one is, what is the difference between fit and transform in Python? So when you use the first one, that is fit, it is used to extract some information from your data and it is applied onto the object. But when you transform it on the other side, this is used when you would want to apply some changes directly. So the first one would extract features and apply, while the second one would directly apply these changes. So here, if you can see, we've substantiated it with an example. So the imputer will spot the missing values and it will get the mean. But in the next step, it will replace the missing values by the mean. So here in step one, we are just trying to see where all the value would fit. But in transform, we are removing the NA values, or we are removing the missing values and we're replacing them with the mean. So this is what happens in transform. It's a two-step process, very simple and easy and straightforward to understand. Right. So the next one is, why don't we create arrays in R? Okay. Now this is because when we talk about R, R Studio works or is made directly or indirectly for statistics. It works great when it is put to use on the front, or in front of general statistics or basic mathematics. So it becomes very easy for R because it's a tool that can very easily work with data frames as well, unlike Python. Now in Python, what do the two methods, that is fit, transform, do? And we've already seen what is fit and transform. So here I'm directly talking about fit underscore transform, which is one single functionality. So here, this is basically like a combination of what we spoke above. So, and we are trying to again substantiate it with a couple of examples wherein we have label encoder in the first place and we have one hot encoder in the second place. So when we talk about label encoder, let us assume that we have options of three countries. That is, as written here, we have France, we have Spain, and we have Germany. Now here your system would automatically allot values of 0, 1 and 2 because you would want to convert the information here from categorical into integer. And likewise, when you use one hot encoder, it would create separate columns for each of the different labels with a binary value of 0 and 1. And it would also separate the columns which for dummy variables, and you could remove them later. So this is what fit transform basically does when we talk about Python. The last question in R, why don't we manually create dummy variables like we do in Python? Because they are automatically created when we use the factor function. So the moment you use or you give this functionality, which is factor, your system would understand that this is what you need. And we can visually see this when you start a regression or a classification process. We have the option of viewing your data set or viewing how your model is being modeled on the right hand side. So you could click on that and you can see in R, how are these dummy variables created and how can they be eliminated all the details about it. So R on those terms becomes very friendly as compared to Python. In Python, you might want to again explicitly type the functionality to check the plots, but in R you have things on a very ready-made basis, wherein you can directly go to plots or you can directly check how neat and how vast and how fast they're being developed and how fast you have an output as well. So this is some basic difference between R and Python. In the upcoming video, we'll be taking a look at questions which are at a bit more deeper level. And if you really like the video and you find this useful, please do not forget to share and subscribe. And if you're looking for interview trainings in depth, then please feel free to reach out to me on Hyderabadi Chora on Instagram or varunrao_gemini@yahoo.com, and we'll see or we'll come up with a plan, a personalized, customized plan about your interview trainings. So that's it from my side. I hope you have enjoyed watching the video, and I also hope that you've learned something new. You have a great day out there. Stay subscribed, and as I said, do not forget to watch the next video. So if you would really want a notification about it, then you might not want to forget to hit the bell icon that you see. So thank you. Have a great day and all the very best for the interview that you're about to take up. This is me, Varun Rao, signing off.